If you like permafreeze teams and big damage, Ayaka is the character to have on your account. With a monster kit at C0 and a skyrocket in DPS once you get her C3 and C4, there's something for everyone with Ayaka, whether you're a free-to-play player or a whale that's trying to speedrun Abyss. If you want your Ayaka to do the most damage that she can, today's guide will cover the usual best artifacts and weapons to general playstyle and team compositions. Without further ado, let's get this guide rolling. Surprisingly enough, Ayaka's basic attacks are actually the most complicated part of her kit when considering optimization due to how simple her elemental skill and burst are. If you don't really care about optimization, you should at least briefly learn about the alternate sprint, which is a core part of her kit. Ayaka's alternate sprint is called Kamisato Art Senho, and when Ayaka reappears after releasing the sprint button, she gains cryo infusion on her attacks for 5 seconds and applies cryo onto nearby enemies. With her Ascension 4 talent, successfully applying cryo onto the enemy with the exit of her alternate sprint will refund 10 stamina and also give Ayaka 18% cryo damage bonus for 10 seconds. Getting the stamina refund and applying cryo onto your enemies for animo characters to swirl are only some of the crucial features that contribute to her S-tier DPS rankings, so it's important to understand and master the feel of her alternate sprint. For those who do care about optimization, let's talk about her basic attack chains. Depending on the situation, it's in your best interest to change how many normal attacks to use before using her special and flashy looking charge attack. Let's start off with the one normal attack into a charge attack combo, often abbreviated N1C by theorycrafters. This is probably the least recommended combo due to how inefficient it is for your stamina, but it does have niche use in AoE situations and when enemies are lifted by Venti's burst. The real good stuff comes with N2C, N3C, and N4C, each with their own benefits depending on the situation. For N2C, which is two normal attacks into a charge attack, this is simply your most optimized combo for DPS. For N3C, having three normal attacks before your charge attack has slightly less DPS than the two normal attack combo, but if you're using Xing Qiu, it allows you to get more rain swords from his elemental burst if he's your source of hydro application. And lastly, for N4C, it also has slightly less DPS than the two normal attack combo, but its biggest benefits are saving stamina and how clean it looks in terms of animation. I mean, seriously, you can't look at this and say it's not cool. Ayaka's elemental skill deals cryo damage in an area around her, generates 4 or 5 cryo particles per use, and has a 10-second cooldown. Additionally, after using an elemental skill, Ayaka's first ascension talent will also grant a 30% increased damage buff to her normal and charge attacks for 6 seconds. During the downtime of her burst, Ayaka really has nothing else to do aside from utilize her cryo infusion or switch to supports, so this is a nice bonus to utilize if you don't need to switch Ayaka out. Ayaka's elemental burst costs 80 energy, has a 20-second cooldown, and launches a snowstorm that moves forward and slashes enemies for cryo damage. If every single slash of the snowstorm hits, then Ayaka's burst will deal a total of 19 slashes, plus a final cut at the end that has a slightly higher damage multiplier. For the more advanced theorycrafting topics, there are two more things you need to understand about Ayaka's burst: snapshotting and internal cooldown. Snapshotting in Genshin Impact is a mechanic where certain abilities that last over a period of time calculate their damage output based on when the ability was first cast and do not consider certain changes to stats after the ability is cast. Not all stats can be snapshotted, but the most common stats to consider are attack and damage bonuses, such as elemental damage bonus or burst damage bonus when it comes to snapshotting. In Ayaka's case, her elemental burst is an ability that snapshots, so we need to make sure we activate all of our attack buffs, cryo damage buffs, and elemental burst damage buffs before casting her burst. So if you're using a character like Kazuha, for example, it's important to swirl cryo before Ayaka casts her elemental burst to grant her the elemental damage bonus from Kazuha's passive. If you swirl cryo after Ayaka launches her burst, you might still get a damage increase, but not as big of a damage increase. Because the 4-set Viridescent Veneer effect is considered a debuff and not a buff, it is not confined within the rules and realm of snapshotting. However, the elemental damage bonus is a direct buff to Ayaka's stats and will not be considered for extra damage under the rules of snapshotting because the buff did not exist when Ayaka pressed the button to cast her elemental burst. The second advanced mechanic to understand with Ayaka's burst is internal cooldown, aka the rate at which an attack can apply its corresponding element onto the enemy. Ayaka's burst has a standard ICD, which translates into cryo application onto the enemy every 3 hits of her burst, with the final cut of her burst guaranteed to apply cryo. Truthfully, it hardly makes a difference in Freeze teams, but her standard ICD makes it clear that although Melt Ayaka is still very much a viable playstyle, it's not as ridiculous as some would make it out to be. The fact that Ayaka can only melt about one third of her elemental burst's hits in Melt isn't very enticing for most players because her stat requirements skyrocket without the comfort of the 4-set Blizzard Strayer's crit rate. Even disregarding Ayaka's standard ICD, Freeze is an extremely comfortable team for her because it can keep smaller enemies frozen in place to guarantee that all of the slashes from her burst land on the enemy. With Melt Ayaka, smaller enemies can constantly get knocked back by her elemental burst, which causes it to occasionally miss, mess up positioning, and even moves you away from any stationary fields like Bennett's burst or Shenhe's burst. Just a quick note on constellations, before we move into artifacts, Ayaka is a very polarizing character in terms of constellations, but in a good way. Most players would be delighted to hear that you really only need C0 Ayaka, since she already does massive damage without any constellations, and none of her constellations unlock a crucial mechanic that limits her kit at C0. However, heavy spenders should consider going for C4, which reduces the defense of enemies hit by her burst by 60%. Defense reduction is the best debuff in the game, and it's no surprise that C4 skyrockets Ayaka's personal DPS and is commonly used by speedrunners to set up a huge nuke reaction with a character like Hu Tao. Ayaka's artifacts are straightforward given that 90% of players will be using her in Freeze teams or Mono Crow teams. The 4-set Blizzard Strayer is a no-brainer as Ayaka's best in slot artifact because it can give up to 40% free crit rate against frozen enemies. Without the full 4-set Blizzard Strayer, you typically want to pair a 2-set Blizzard Strayer set with either the 2-set Noblesse Oblige or any 2-set that gives attack percent. If you need to run the 2-set combinations, you're either currently farming the 4-set Blizzard Strayer but don't have good enough pieces yet, or you're running a Melt Ayaka and can't get any value out of Blizzard Strayer's 4-set effect. As for artifact stats, Ayaka almost always wants attack percent in the Sands, cryo damage in the Goblet, and crit damage in the Circlet. Crit rate in the Circlet is much less favorable unless you're running a Melt Ayaka or your other pieces have ridiculous crit damage substats. Substat focus usually prioritizes energy recharge until you hit anywhere between the range of 140 to 150% total ER, and then crit damage, attack percent, and crit rate come afterwards. With the Inazuma craftable Amenoma Kageuchi, Ayaka can hover closer to 120% energy recharge at R1 and even down to 110% at higher refinements. Speaking of Amenoma Kageuchi, it's the perfect segue into the weapon section. If you don't have any 5-star swords, the only 4-star sword you should ever consider on Ayaka is the Inazuma craftable Amenoma Kageuchi. This free-to-play sword provides everything Ayaka can ask for out of a 4-star weapon, and its refinements are also quite valuable. Amenoma Kageuchi has a high secondary attack stat to complement Ayaka's high base attack, and its energy-based passive can reduce her energy requirements at 20% at R1. For each refinement that you have, it allows you to drop another energy recharge roll in artifact substats, equating to about 5% per refinement. All other swords to consider on Ayaka are 5-star weapons, but instead of starting at the best option like normal, let's actually start from the 5-star swords that are close to Amenoma Kageuchi and then make our way up to the best options last. Skyward Blade's biggest benefit is its high energy recharge stat, which completely nullifies the need to focus any energy recharge in artifact substats. If you don't have any billets to spare, then Skyward's energy and damage output is very comparable to that of R5 Amenoma Kageuchi, but otherwise I really wouldn't use this weapon on Ayaka over a character that can actually appreciate it like Bennett or Jean. Next, we have Light of Foliar Incision, Alhatham's signature weapon. Although it has a very enticing 88.2% crit damage stat, what holds this weapon back is the passive, which increases normal attack and elemental skill damage based on your elemental mastery stat. While you might have some elemental mastery in melt teams, an optimal freeze Ayaka has a grand total of 0 EM, which translates to 0 buffs from the passive. Summit Shaper comes in as the 4th best option for Ayaka, especially when paired with Diona or Layla. Oftentimes, you won't have a fully stacked passive for Ayaka's burst, but generally the ridiculous amount of attack that this weapon provides makes it a solid DPS upgrade from Amenoma Kageuchi. The 3rd best weapon for Ayaka is Primordial Jade Cutter. Similar to how Light of Foliar Incision is held back by its EM-based passive, Jade Cutter is held back by its copious amounts of crit rate. It's extremely easy to overcap 100% crit rate with Jade Cutter, the 4-set Blizzard Strayer, and the Cryo Resonance active all at the same time, so generally the high crit rate is really appreciated only in melt teams. Despite this, a small but respectable boost to attack thanks to the weapon's passive and the need to not focus any crit rate at all in artifact substats still keeps the weapon as the respectable third best sword for Ayaka. Funnily enough, the second best sword for Ayaka is her brother's signature weapon, Horan Geppaku Futsu. Not only does it boast a lower crit rate stat and a higher base attack stat compared to Primordial Jade Cutter, but it also has a small buff of 12% elemental damage bonus at R1. The only weapon that Horan pales in comparison to is, of course, Ayaka's own signature weapon, Mistsplitter Reforged. Mistsplitter has 3 stacks of elemental damage bonus. One stack is obtained by landing an elemental normal attack, one is obtained by casting your elemental burst, and the last one is obtained by having less than 100% energy. Playing Ayaka naturally obtains the stacks pertaining to energy and casting your elemental burst, but with Mistsplitter, it's always important to normal attack once before casting your elemental burst to snapshot the last elemental damage stack onto your burst. Ayaka's freeze teams are both a nightmare to work with and a blessing to build because of how many options she has. One could say that the strongest Ayaka freeze team includes Ayaka, Shen-He, Kokomi with the thrilling tales of Dragon Slayer's Catalyst, and Kazuha in the last slot. But there are always certain scenarios where one or two of these supports are replaced for other options. I'll do my best to run through all the common substitutes to this baseline team and give you an idea of when these substitutes are ideal. I want to emphasize that Ayaka's freeze teams pride themselves on variety, so don't be afraid to use whatever you have available on your account. Starting off with the second cryo slot, if you don't have Shen-He, our goal in this slot is either to provide cryo buffs, cryo energy, or survivability. If we're looking at cryo buffs, the other option that comes to mind is a support Ganyu. Her burst provides a 20% cryo damage bonus, and when paired with Venti, both Ayaka and Ganyu's burst can deal insane amounts of damage against the grouped enemies. Support Ganyu can also wield the 4-set Noblesse Oblige to provide an additional 20% attack on top of the 20% cryo damage bonus she already gives to Ayaka. If you need cryo energy, look no further than Kaya or Rosaria. Both of these 4-star characters have exceptional energy generation on a short 6-second cooldown, and they also provide respectable damage with their bursts as well. Lastly, if you need survivability, that brings us to Diona or Layla. These two are my personal favorites for cryo supports because they don't just double dip, but they triple dip by also providing buffs and cryo energy. Setting up their shields generates energy for Ayaka in the process, and Diona can carry the 4-set Noblesse, while Layla can carry the 4-set Tenacity for a 20% attack buff. Additionally, whenever you need healing or shielding on the team, using Diona and Layla frees up Kokomi from that duty and allows you to run Mona, Yulon, or Xing Qiu. Mona is more focused on team buffs, while Yulon and Xing Qiu provide a huge chunk of personal damage. Whichever one you choose to use is completely dependent on your account since Ayaka doesn't need specific levels of hydro application like some bloom-based teams do. If you want to use an offensive cryo option and don't have Kokomi, then Barbara can also hold the Thrilling Tales Catalyst and function as a budget Kokomi. Just keep in mind that her hydro application is very awkward and may require the help of a hydro-infused Kazuha, Venti, or Sucrose burst. With the mention of Kazuha, Venti, and Sucrose, what's the difference between them in the Anemo slot? Well, it should be obvious that Kazuha's elemental damage buffing and strong grouping ability makes him the strongest overall option for Ayaka. Venti is a little more niche since his value falls off against enemies that cannot be pulled by his elemental burst, but he excels when paired with Ganyu or if your Ayaka has poor energy generation. Lastly, Sucrose is just the budget Anemo option if you don't have the limited 5 stars. She can also group enemies with her elemental burst and hold either the Thrilling Tales Catalyst to buff Ayaka or the Favonius Codex to provide energy to the team. If you need healing in the Anemo slot when you have no cryo or hydro healers, then Jean or Sayu are also viable, but generally they aren't recommended because they don't really provide anything else. Ayaka's melt teams follow the same formula as any other Ganyu, Kaya, or Rosaria melt team. Usually the team will consist of Ayaka, a cryo support, Bennett, and then Xiangling, Kazuha, or Jean in the last slot. Despite Ayaka's burst ICD, it's extremely hard to keep up constant pyro application in a classic reverse melt team, bar the Sunfire setup with Bennett and Jean's burst together. As a result, in the Xiangling setup for example, Ayaka can get a big melt reaction with her elemental skill, then use her burst to start applying cryo for Xiangling's pyronado to start melting from where they both support each other. Because Kazuha cannot keep up with Ayaka's constant cryo application by himself, the Kazuha variant becomes less of a melt team and more of a hyper carry team. Your Ayaka will do damage regardless of whether or not she actually gets all of the melt reactions she can because of the absurd pairing of Bennett and Kazuha. That's just something to keep in mind for those looking to play melt Ayaka. With that, let me know your thoughts, builds, and teams for Ayaka down in the comments below. If you enjoyed this guide or thought it was useful, be sure to support both the video and the channel. You can follow me on Twitch, Instagram, TikTok, or sub to the YouTube channel, whatever people do nowadays. Other than that, it's the same as always. I'll see y'all in the next one. Peace.